So now we have to go to the second paper by Professor Natalia Lidova. She has specialized in Natyashastra and Natural. So she will be presenting her paper, Unity and Universality, Tradition of Ancient Indian Theatre. So now I invite Professor Natalia Lidova to present her paper.
First of all, I want to thank all of you, the colleagues, and distinguished
Swamis.
Allowed? It's not
allowed?
Yeah, distinguished Swamis of Ramakrishna Mission for the opportunity to be here to present my paper, participate in this very, very interesting. So my paper is concerned about unity and universality in the tradition of ancient Indian theatre. The question of unity and universality in the tradition of ancient Indian theatre is so comprehensive and many-sided that its detailed analysis requires much wider framework than the limited volume of one article. Nevertheless, in this paper, I will try to bring to light various facts and evidences showing that both of these highly theoretical humanitarian concepts are particularly relevant for the discussed subject. According to the Natyashastra, the oldest and the most authoritative of all available sources of ancient Indian drama, the unity of the theater reflected the idea of harmony and highest beauty of the multiple sides of existence, and manifested itself in an effort to maintain a balance or supreme equilibrium of the values of the universe. Theater was born as a divine art that clarified and harmonized the world, and provided it the opportunity to rise up toward the infinite unity and regularity of the cosmos. This is why Indian theatre, already in its cradle at the very moment of its origin, was conceived as a universal art. It was a kind of activity that was destined to create a perfect time-space continuum which would embrace the ideal geography of holy islands, Drupas, in divine time, consisting of four global epochs or eras, yugas, that succeeded each other in the degrading and newly revolving universe. Therefore, it is not surprising that a divine mandala, the center of which was identified with the supreme god Brahma, became the scene of this universal theater. The divine drama performed in this perfect stage involved, united, and refined the entire universe, establishing an eternal paradigm of its perpetual motion. Theater was designed to run this movement and get the world to rotate in a perfect circle, delineated around of three goals of life, dharma, karma, and artha. At the same time, theater was not exclusively a form of art, but the highest wisdom and ultimate divine knowledge, accommodating all sciences, arts, and crafts, and intended to educate people and teach them in entertainment, thus creating a new type of man on the basis of noble goals of higher morality. We learn more about it from the opening chapter of Natyashastra, known as Natyapatyaya, or The Origin of the Theatre, which explicitly formulates the idea of its divine origin. The actual drama and knowledge of it were originally named Natyaveda. Natyashastra names Brahma as its creator and emphasizes its divine descent. Theatre appeared at the borderline between Krita Yuga and Treta Yuga, when the moral seriously fell on heaven and earth. Unable to cope on his own, Indra, the king of gods, appealed to Brahma, asking him to make something for all varnas to see and hear, including Shudras, who were not previously admitted to the Vedas. As he agreed to help, Brahma chose the typical Brahmanic way. He created a new sacral knowledge. As he is making the fifth Veda, Brahma is amply summarize them, the most essential elements of four previous Vedas, such as recitation, the basis of Rig Veda, and singing, the core of Samaveda. An all-embracing doctrine emerged in Natya Veda, for as he determines to make, I quote, a fifth Veda entitled Natya, which shall be conducive to Dharma, Artha, as well as glory, Yashas, which he placed here erotic passion, Kama, which is more traditional for later Jivaka. Natya Shastra contains a lot of early stages of these very important concepts, which well, were first developed in Hinduism. His Veda, I quote, shall contain good counsel and collection of deductive maxims, shall give guidance to the future people, and all their actions will be enriched by the teaching of all Shastras and demonstrate all types of arts and crafts. It's Natya Shastra 1.15. Thus creating a new Veda, Brahma proceeded from many great texts of the Vedic canon. Apart from the four Vedic Samhitas, he used the supplementary Vedas with Upaveda, all Shastras without exception, knowledge of the various arts and crafts, and an instruction of Karma and Artha. When his work was over, Brahma passed the Natya Veda to the most worthy of the Brahmins, Maharata, and suggested that the Brahmin should study and enact it with his 100 sons. It's Natya Shastra 54-55. The first students of Natya Shastra regarded this legend as an aid solely to elevate the theater by using the influence of the Vedic tradition. Imparting the stages of holy rite on what was in fact an art which originated much later and was circular in content. Studies of the latest decades, on the contrary, even more often regard the mythological content of the Natya Shastra as a reliable historical source which retained in a mythical form many actual events of the era in which the drama was emerging. This approach reflects the whole range of contemporary research methods applied to ancient texts, with mythology regarded as a specific type of language used by man during certain periods of his cultural history to analyze and describe the phenomena surrounding him. No doubt, the persistent desire of the author of Natya Veda to present the treatise as part and parcel of the Vedic canon and its continuation did not arise but sheer chance. We ought not to take this presentation at its face value to regard this work as a fifth Veda, yet this title ascribed to it is indicative in itself as an oblique evidence to the time when the treatise took shape. As we know, the first ever reference to the fifth Veda is to be found in the Chandogya Upanishad. It is 7.1-7.7.1. I quote, Venerable Sir, I know the Rig Veda, the Yajur Veda, the Sama Veda, Adharvana as the fourth Veda, Itihasa Purana as the fifth. Where Itihasa is usually translated as epic and Purana as ancient lore. Of the two great epics of ancient India, the Mahabharata was the one to receive the sublime title of the fifth Veda. Within its own text, the same epic is referred to as Itihasa. It's many times, for example, Mahabharata 156.16 and Purana. It's Mahabharata 1.115, 156.15, etc. While the Ramayana traditionally describes itself as Akhyana. It is indicative in the sense that the Natya Veda Brahma's creation is also named Itihasa, as we see repeated several times in the opening chapter of the Natya Shastra. For example, 1.15, which says that Brahma created, I quote, a fifth Veda entitled Natya, which makes one with the Itihasa. An even clearer reference is found elsewhere, I quote, After he created the Natya Veda, Pitamaha Brahma addressed to mighty Indra, I created the Itihasa, and it is intended for gods, Nati Shastra 1:19. The first reductions of Mahabharata are considered to have taken shape in the middle of the first millennium BC. Neither the Vedic Samhitas nor the Brahmanas contain direct oblique references to Nati Mahabharata, while sources from the latter half of the first millennium BC mention frequently enough not only the name of this epic, but the name of its heroes. The situation with the Natya Veda is more or less similar. The Vedic texts are silent on drama, but as we cross the conventional borderline of the mid-first millennium BC, testimony of centricals appears in numerous texts, epigraphic data, and works of the Buddhist tradition among them. As is the case with the Mahabharata, Panini's grammar, which is a majority of scholars date to the 4th century BC, provides essential witness to determine the earliest time when drama emerged. Among treatises which appeared in the various Vedic schools, Panini mentions two Nata Sutras by Shivalingam Krishashva. The difference made by Panini between the Mrita's dance and Natya as a more sophisticated scenic performance shows that the theater had taken shape by that time. A number of scholars, among them Manmohan Ghosh, to whom belongs an important published in Calcutta edition and translation of the treatise, the only translation which is available till now, date the oldest contemptual stratum of the Natya Shastra to the 5th century BC. To all appearances, we can see it as the actual time when the Natya Veda appeared. We cannot rule out that the very concept of the 5th Veda emerged at that time. At that very time, the watershed between the late Vedic and early Epic eras. Earlier, in the Vedic time proper, the doctrine of three and later four Vedas was so important that the appearance of the considerable number of texts which announced themselves as the 5th Veda would be preposterous as breaking the available hierarchy of the Vedic monuments. Also, the later treatise, medieval among them, was so far separated in time from the Vedic era that they could not aspire the status of Vedic works only in a metaphorical sense. While the mid-first millennium BC was a unique time so closely linked with the Vedic culture, then the very title of Veda still fully retained its original sacred and semiotic message. On the other hand, that era was characteristic for crucial reforms in the worldview which created the very possibility of an unharassed extension of the Vedic canon. The legend of Natya Shastra describes the era when the Natya Veda emerged as a time of trials and tribulations, which came as a borderline when the Dritta Yuga passed to the Chaturanga. It was a time when religious precepts were given up and sensual pleasures prevailed. More than that, the creation of a 5th Veda was necessitated by the situation of decline of piety. As Natya Shastra repeatedly emphasizes, Brahma's work, this compendium of universal knowledge, which laid open to the heart of all crafts and all scholarly erudition, was able to improve man in his depravity and restore the shattered order of things. In the actual historical time, this situation presented at the close of the Dritta Yuga corresponded to a period known as the excess time of Indian civilization, when the pillars of the ancient Vedic religion, which had before appeared eternal, were profoundly shaken. The esoteric quality of the Brahmanic culture with an ideal community of the twice born as its supreme goal evoke a chaos of the anti-Brahmanic religious trends. The crisis of the Vedic ritualism, mainly the solemn Vedic Somayajna rituals, predetermined the decline of the Brahmanic tradition. Even though Brahmanic theology insisted, as before, on their obligatory and regular performance, the actual status of the shroud to rise had fallen far below these demands. As we know, the reformatory spirit of that time gave rise to a wealth of religious trends. One of them, Buddhism and Jainism were destined to play a crucial part in Indian culture. Others were doomed to survive only as a distant, semi-legendary echo of the tradition. They all shared one vital duty: to offer alternative routes of further development, largely due to the necessity to reform the Brahmanic ritual system. In particular, Buddhism and Jainism gave rise to relatively rare variants of extra-ritual religious movements, which gave up patently in their sacral practices. As I see it, that was a response to the unpopularity of Vedic ritualism. A doctrine which helped to introduce the puja, this new form of worship perceived by the Aryan communities utterly outlandish, appears to have proposed another way out of this problem. The Nadi Shastra singles out that none other than puja as pivotal in the emergence of the theatrical tradition. On the divine commandment of Brahma, creator of the knowledge of the Natya Veda, every performance was to be preceded with puja. I quote, "Either the stage or the dramatic performance should not be held without puja, and he who will hold the stage and the dramatic performance without puja will find his knowledge useless, and he will come to a bad reverse. For this is puja for the deities on the stage, which is similar to the yajna." It's Nati Shastra 1-5-1-6. This testimony of Nati Shastra is of essential importance, first because it refers to the puja as a pivotal ritual of Natya Veda, and second because it compares puja to yajna as two different rituals. The quoted passage in Natya Shastra is extremely important for tracing the links between Natya Veda and the Vedic canon, makes us turn to what may well be one of the most complicated problems in Indology, a problem that has hitherto defined solution.